We have today with us our speaker, Dr. Sumit Sen, who is coming in from San Francisco. He lives there now and does a variety of things, mostly related to brain sciences. And brain sciences along with behavioral sciences and how these come together in the early childhood development, how brain works. So it's a lot of research application, particularly because from the medical sciences it's application. I'm not going to read out all of that that is written here. You will get to know. Maybe you can talk about yourself also if you want. But it's quite overwhelming for me as well here, because we grew up together in the same school, and then of course as a very bright student he took up medicine. And then completed his medicine from Calcutta Medical College, went abroad, did a variety of studies and research, and has been there for almost 3 decades now. And he's come here again, like most of us who has come here as a child and has marveled at Nalanda and has always wanted to see the Nalanda back and thriving again. This is one of the occasions and one of the inspirations to come back and stand in front and see this really coming together. So I think this is a great occasion for all of us to be together here and discuss something of academic interest, cutting edge research that is going on into how brain development actually can be manipulated, and the interventions that can be done which can have a beneficial outcome on society. So that's something which is very interesting and exciting. I've been discussing with him off and on, and therefore when he decided to come and see us here, I took this opportunity and said he must come and talk to us. I think all of us would enjoy his talk. Thank you so much for coming here.
Thank you, Dr. Bonifada, for this great opportunity, and thank you everyone for having me here. Today's talk is a culmination of hours and hours of on-the-phone discussion with Dr. Bonifada about what I do and how relates to society at large. A very important side interest of me for since college times has been economics, even though I have been in medicine all my life. And I can see now how what we do at our end can impact society at large. So that one that has taken up, this all of it sounds so interesting. Yeah, it would be great to have you talk to a group. I'd love to. This is a very unusual group for me. Yeah. Oh, thank you. So thank you for.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah. I speak extensively with my colleagues as part of the Early Childhood Development Subcommittee of the American Academy of Pediatrics. I spend a lot of time speaking with my colleague pediatricians and getting them up to date with this very exciting area. I also speak extensively with parent groups, helping them understand the importance of what we do. For most parents, when they bring their child to the pediatrician, they have only one question: is my child gaining weight? And I talk about that weight is not the only thing to focus on. A far bigger thing is going on. And that couldn't be more emphasized at a great group like yours, who's constantly using your mind to do the great work you do. And it's
So this is the first time I'm actually kind of feeling a little bit talking to a non-medical, non-parent group. So definitely feel free to stop me anytime and ask me any questions. As people always, they always want to hear from me, and I always ask them, how much do you want to hear? And please feel free to stop me if I'm boring you with details, because I have a geeky interest in what I do. But so I can go on and on for days and weeks and months about the stuff we do. But I hope you find this talk enjoyable. And my slides also are more as in providing headlines rather than information. The last thing I like to do is for the entire audience reading the slide. I'd rather have an interactive discussion with you and a conversation, engaging you. And so if it's okay with you, I might even ask a question to the audience as a cue in to what we're going to talk about. Is that okay? Any questions so far? Is that okay with that? Great. So all of us were a child once upon a time. We were born, the day we were born, we actually used very little of our brain. To be very stark, all we do is eat and poop and sleep. That's all we do when we're born. You know, sometimes parents, when they have first of a baby, they are overwhelmed, oh my God, it's so hard to take care of a newborn baby. Not really. As long as you can feed the baby and clean the diaper and provide a safe environment for the baby to sleep, then we're good to go. And we all started our life that way, including me. And here we are. You guys, this great academic environment of Nalanda University. And how do we get there? A common thing that sometimes, actually let me ask anybody in the audience, do you today have more functioning brain cells today than you did on the day you were born? Anybody want to venture an answer? Feel free to, don't be afraid, yes?
Yeah. I definitely don't have a function of brain, so I was trying to catch a mosquito, I'm sorry. It's a very big mosquito, I'm sure.
But think about it, right? How many, and so one would think that that's a pretty simple process, right? You're catching a mosquito. But think about it, if I may have your name, please.
Aditya.
Okay. Aditya. Thank you. So, just that simple act alone, how many brain centers do you think he used to do that simple thing? So here he is very engaged, thinking about what we're going to talk about, and he's listening, and at the same time he hears the zzzz, which is a different part of the brain, maybe. The mosquito even landed on some part of your body, annoying you. You maybe even used another part of the body to have a feeling about that stupid mosquito that made you feel like catch it or kill it. And so you're now multitasking, and now your whole brain is alive. And in a delicate dance, you're listening, you focus, you're watching here, the mosquito is there, and you're controlling a part of your arm to move towards the mosquito. Why do you think about this? This whole simple action itself used somewhere about 14 to 16 different centers of the brain. Right? A study show that we are only aware of somewhere about 20 to 30% of what our brain does for us. Most of it's automatic. The brain is a giant, not a giant, it's only this tiny, but it's a very complicated computer. And most of what it does is automatically. And we feel it only when something is not working. Has anybody had any experience taking care of maybe a family member or a friend who has undergone a stroke? Anyone? Yes? Yeah? Stroke is an injury to any random part of the brain, whether by interruption of blood supply or hemorrhage. Do you need a place to? You okay? Yeah. By the way, how much time do I have?
About 40 minutes.
40 minutes. Most of what we know today about what our brain does is the effect of what we call microstrokes, where a tiny part of the brain is knocked out, and therefore a person loses a tiny bit of function. And then over the last 30, 40 years, we have accumulated that information to have a pretty detailed map of what our brain does. But today, we are going the next step in actively able to, we have very advanced ways to find out even at this time, at this moment, what part of my brain am I using to, in actual time, study that? Yes, please.
Could you please explain that how the brain development happens? Because when we are starting with the brain development, when the child is born, so what amount of brain is developed? And in about 1 year, how much is developed? Or 5 years, how much is developed? The early child is how many years you need? And when I'm grown up now, is it fully developed? Because there are many stories that even Einstein could not use more than 11% or like that. So what is the level of...
Great question, I love it. You know, so that's why I don't have too much material on the slides, because questions like these actually lead on to interesting discussions where we'll learn more. So, I had raised a question earlier as to whether we have more brain cells today than the day we were born.
No.
The, yes?
No.
No, right? Well, maybe I'm getting old and I have less than the day I was born. But an average baby has the same number of brain cells or neurons compared to an average 25 to 30 year old adult. Same number. So then, how come we went from a baby who only eats, poops, and sleeps, goes to a functioning adult by the age of 25 to 30, hopefully. Okay. Some people are maybe learning a little later. So the reason is what is called connectivity. So by the time we are fully mature and functioning, an average brain cell will connect with somewhere in the range, every neuron is different, 3,000 to 5,000 of the neurons in various different parts of the brain. And therefore leads to the number of connections in the brain that is more. So I had to actually look at what kind of real number I can give to anyone that would kind of put that in perspective. So I looked it up. The total number of fish in all the oceans combined is less than the number of connections we have in our brain. Does that put that in perspective? That is very complicated. So, as I mentioned earlier, the brain is the most complicated computer there is. It is a computer. Even though we like to feel that we're humans, we have feelings, we have curiosity, we're in university, we raise kids, we have friendships, we fall in love, we have all these very human characteristics. It's all a function of that computer up there. Yeah. Oh, one of those. The biggest difference in the computer of the brain and the computer that we all use, including this computer that we're using for a slide generation, the computers as we know today works in a binary system of on and off circuits. The brain does not work in that, the brain computer does not work that way. The brain, actually each neuron will fire and send signals down several pathways all at the same time, up to sometimes thousands, and optimize the most efficient electrical circuitry to perform a particular action, and then fire through using that circuit. Google, Apple, and Microsoft, all three have active divisions that are working to how to simulate the computer of the brain in real life computers, which is going to happen, which raises ethical questions. Yeah, will those computers then feel, love, and do other emotional things that humans do? It may be possible one day, we never know. So how does it go that way? Like your question, how does the brain go from being a very simplistic jumble of brain cells or neurons to a complicated functioning adult, even though the number of neurons are not going up, is by increasing the number of electrical connections with ever increasing number of other brain cells or neurons, eventually leading up to 3,000 to 5,000 other neurons for each neuron affected. And the weird part of all of that is that it does it on its own, automatically, as a result of stimulation from the environment. Okay? So to put it as an extreme example, if you took a baby and put that baby in a dark box, which has air and oxygen, and fed the baby through a tube, and the box was even soundproofed, and therefore the baby was unable to see, feel, we have 5 senses, right? See, feel, smell, and it's a box, so there's it's presumed that there's no smell involved in the box, or hear anything. Do you think 25 years later that baby will be the size of the baby, or will they have grown? The baby's being fed, and the baby's growing, and they're breathing the air in that box. Do you think the baby will grow? In size? Yeah, the baby will grow in size. May not achieve without movement, the muscles may not grow as right, the skeletal bones may not grow right, but that baby is not going to be the size of the baby 25 years later. The size will be bigger. At the same time, 25 years later, will that person behave like a baby, or a 25-year-old, or somewhere in between? Will behave like a baby. That baby's brain has not been stimulated by all the other 5 senses in a collaborative way to increase the connections to that complicated set of 3,000 to 5,000 connections per neuron. Does that answer your question? Yeah. So to illustrate that point, my first patient with autism, which is a problem with brain connectivity, was taller than me, bigger than me, 16 years old, had to be dragged into the office, being held by five people. He was institutionalized. He was functioning at the level of 6 months. So to add further challenge to my talk, this is the first time I'm talking in front of my parents. I'm literally shaking in my village. And my son. It's never happened before. So thank you for welcoming me. So now, as you can see, the interruptions of the development of the brain will dramatically alter function, leading to lack of human productivity, which is what we call it in our case. Yes.
So as you said, the baby in that box will grow in so-called maturity. So is it like this, that if a person is involved in many tasks, various different kind of tasks, his or her brain is going to be grow in a very complicated way, and he or she will grow much more mature.
Excellent question. Love it. Can I have a show of hands? How many here are aware of the term nature versus nurture? Yeah. You've heard of this. What does that mean? So nature is what we were born with, and nurture affects the brain development based on what we are exposed to afterwards. So I'll give you, I study intensely early childhood development, and I'll give you a fact in the United States, very interesting. And most of my patients I take care of are under 5 years of age. And even within that group, most of my patients I take care of are under 3 years of age. And in that early group, as I study their brain function, there are very technical tools to assess that, that is beyond the scope of this talk. What we find is that no matter what the parentage or the economic background of a baby is, that their problem-solving skills, their perceptive skills are pretty much the same across the board. Yet, after 3, their function starts to diverge. And those kids who were exposed to stimulation in their environment, typically being the middle and the upper class of socioeconomic class, the parents are more interested in having a smart child and therefore exposing their child to many different stimulatory activities. That child, no matter how low their God-given innate cognitive and intelligence and perceptive skills were, start to improve rapidly, whereas a child in the lower socioeconomic strata, that child may have been born, I see the baby at 6 months, it's like, wow, this kid could be very sharp. And they would see them back at 12 months and 18 months and 24 months of age, and I'm very impressed. But then after 3, if that child is not provided with a lot of positive stimulatory activities, unfortunately, is unable to lead to the full natural abilities that the achieved. Does that answer your question? Yeah. Very interesting. So, yeah, were you asking a question? Yeah, please.
Yeah. I just want to come back to what you said about relationships. It seems to be a relationship between the brain, the way it develops, and the environment. So stimulus results in a certain set of neural networks and the expansion of those neural networks. But the other way around, at some point of time, as adults, those neural networks also determine or constrain how we see the environment, or how we respond to the environment.
Very interesting.
Right.
Yes.
So the question is, and so we all know sort of repetitive, you know, we keep doing habitual ways of responding to our social environment or physical environment. So what does that actually suggest in terms of how much, you know, neural networks are open to forming new pathways, or do they get stuck at some point regardless of the number of neurons that you have in the brain?
Excellent question. Yeah. So that's why I don't have much in terms of science. Because the questions you guys raised actually leads to far more interesting discussions that I never cover in constraints of slide presentation. So if I may repeat the question, let me see if I understand the question. So does our brain, in spite of all these stimulations in our environment, eventually stop progressing in its complexity? Is that your question? Or
yes, it's complexity. It seems that, you know, you've noticed oneself and other people, that we have certain very complex and yet fixed ways of responding. And I think humanity is, you know, stuck in a rut in some ways also, right now, you know, in terms of how it's responding to the environment, etc. You could say, well, is that a function of our brain somehow?
So, not
like dinosaurs, but specialized, our brain is getting specialized in response.
Right. So, not necessarily so. So, when I was a kid, we used to think that the brain is not plastic, that the brain does what it does in the first few years of life, and then we become an adult, and we become incorrigible and hopeless. So modern studies are showing that is not true. Our brain changes its connectivity all our lives. And I'll give you some simple examples of that you will appreciate. All of you, at your various, you yourself personally is much more senior to our younger student body, but at the same time, at your stage in your career, you're learning new things, right? And as you're learning new things, your brain is actually changing its wiring. A very amazing example of that, in the United States, we are having an unprecedented number of soldiers coming back from Iraq or Afghanistan who have had, because of the IEDs, the explosive devices, sometimes half their brain blown off. So, quite understandably, in that instant, they lose half their function. Of whichever half of the brain you blew off, come back. These are people in their 20s and 30s. And then with aggressive therapy, they start to regain their function. And they start to regain their function that you wouldn't expect them to have because that part of the brain is missing. So scientists have actually studied the brains of these people as they're acquiring the new function, and what they're finding is a different part of the brain takes over that function that naturally wouldn't have otherwise performed that function. Isn't that amazing? In my own life, I picked up a very challenging activity in my late 40s, skiing. I had in my entire life never had been on a roller skate or balanced on one foot and moving and all that. And after many disastrous falling down the slopes, have now mastered the art of skiing. My brain had massively rewired as a result. I know that. It's already doing new things. Another example of that in practical application that we're seeing is a condition that is probably well known to you all, Alzheimer's disease, where we, as with advanced age, we start to lose brain function. And what we are finding is that one way to reduce the risk of Alzheimer's disease is by constantly acquiring new skills as we advance in age and trying different things in different ways. Like if you're used to brushing your teeth with your right hand, use your left hand, use different parts of your body, engage in more intellectual activities, and that will keep your brain fresh and rewired constantly, so that you don't lose the wiring and end up with Alzheimer's disease.
Now that we were discussing about neuroplasticity, like Professor Malik asked his question, right? And now we are discussing about Alzheimer's. So to which extent can this capacity of the brain to build itself through neuroplasticity help in combating diseases like Alzheimer's? Does, if it does that at all, does neuroplasticity
if I may repeat the question?
Yeah. That's just the bottom of the
screen. Can I have you repeat the question one more time? Please say it louder.
We were discussing about the brain's capacity to be plastic.
Right.
So my question is, if neural plasticity can help the people who are prone to Alzheimer's to combat Alzheimer's, or if they already have Alzheimer's, can neuroplasticity help in treating or curing or reversing the effects of Alzheimer's to some extent?
You can reverse, some studies are showing, but it's not nowhere as close to engaging in constantly more stimulating activities in life to prevent it from developing in the first place. And it's because Alzheimer's is a result of loss of connectivity. So, you know, when I was a kid, we used to say that when we get hit by Alzheimer's, we basically turn into babies. A lot of them, you know, lose their bowel and bladder control. They can't recognize anybody. They lose their memory. They can't, sometimes they may lose even their speech and turn into a big-sized baby. And so to engage in constant stimulating social and intellectual activities leads to prevention, which is far more powerful. Yeah, that's a kind of a cliche. And I would say prevention is worth it. What is that? I'm a cure. Right? So does that answer your question? Okay. Yes, go ahead.
With the example of upper strata and lower strata, we were saying that how receptors shape the neuron activities, and based on that, like how brain grows naturally is decided. So, like it's a lot about nurturing, and so it's all about social activities. So, how social activities shapes natural. So what is natural in this overall growth? So it will all depend on the social factor, not on the natural factor. And where is the boundary between natural factor and the social factors? So like at what times, especially during the childhood intervention or the childhood brain growth, at what time, like if there is no social intervention, then also the brain will grow in the same manner? Or if the brain has stopped growing, like it is facing some neurological disease, so then there is no impact or no influence of social behavior or social influence on the natural.
To give a simple, straight, black and white answer, there are no boundaries. However, there are some age boundaries. That's why we call early childhood intervention, and because
if these issues are not dealt with in very early on in childhood, in the first 2 years of life, then the simplest way I put it to most of my parents is it is hard to do, it may be possible, but it's almost next to impossible to do 7 years of homework in one night. So as the brain increases in its complexity of function by increasing these connectivities with other neurons or brain cells, that takes time. And if you start early on, you're a little bit behind, but you can catch up. Once you're older, it becomes almost harder to catch up. Does that make sense? Yeah. Does that answer your question? So, yes, go ahead.
Is it not the brain development and the mental development?
Brain development and what?
Mental development.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, when we talk about the social interactions, connectivities, relatable things, so this is mainly of mental development. So when we look at the brain development, mainly we look at the neurons, the cells, what we have, isn't it? So I think these are two things that are interdependent. It's not, the mental development of the person is decided by the social interactions and the opportunities we get to, several connectivities. The brain development, for example, that is mainly to do with my nutrition and my, the growth element that is, fitted to me. And it both are related because if I am all nutrition, I'm not able to develop well my neurons, then whatever be the social connectivities I have, I'm not able to see. So what is the relationship between these two?
So that is, I'm sure you're not a neuropsychologist, right?
I'm not sure.
So that is the age-old paradigm as well. There is no difference between mental and brain activity. We are what is our mind. There is a distinct, I'll give you two parts of the brain, maybe three, that we can talk about that will kind of simply illustrate. So we talk about personality, right? We have a friendly personality, a competitive personality, maybe a laid-back personality, and an intense personality. We always talk about these things, right? And those are nothing but a delicate dance between many different centers of the brain. And that leads to who we are. So I can give you a little secret. If you are investing in stocks of a company that produces medications to treat psychiatric disorders, your stock may not do well in 20 to 30 years. In 20 to 30 years of time, we will be treating conditions such as depression, schizophrenia, anxiety disorders, completely differently, addressing the specific brain centers rather than treating them with medications. So, yes?
Can I bring you back to the autism part of the blog? Because your blog was seeming to hint that early, to use sonars for manipulation of the brain. And since I do actively support autism as a cause, I just want to know what is it that you are trying to say about autism. Are you actually suggesting that if people intervene with kids who are getting, who are being diagnosed with autism at 1 or 2 years of age, and the intervention happen at that early, it could be reversed, or what's the theory? What's your hypothesis?
Did everybody hear? Anybody there who did not hear a question? That's a great question. So I get asked that question a lot. What do you think, doctor? And what is your hypothesis? And I am I'm a scientist. I have about 11 years of molecular biology and neuroscience research experience. even though at this present moment I don't actively do research, I prefer to bring together many people's research to benefit children. So I always talk about, because I'm a scientist, that I don't have any blind hypothesis. Everything I talk about is based on fact. And with that having been said, the present day science is talking about, even though the tools are being developed, but the functional brain waves of a baby at the moment that the baby is born, is for that baby, if that baby is destined to develop autism, is different than the other babies who are not destined to develop autism. A revolutionary concept, which means somewhere in the near future, depending on the pace of research, we will be diagnosing autism at birth. Today, we already have screening in the United States and the rest of the world, a lot of screening methods to pick up on other birth defects. Simply put, autism is a birth defect of brain function. It is present at birth. Even though, so why don't we, like just by looking at a baby, not know whether that baby has autism or not? Can anybody, based on what I've said so far, venture a random guess for the answer? Why do we at this present time not know just by looking at the baby whether that baby is destined to? Yes?
I can answer it, yes. Because the baby is not doing much beyond.
That's correct. Excellent. So, I'm sorry.
Or they don't respond the way you expect them to, I think. You expect them to respond in a certain way.
No, her answer was dead on right. A newborn baby does nothing other than eat, pee, poop, and sleep. That's it. And therefore is not using much of the brain, and therefore, by looking at the baby on day one, you'd have no idea. But by using advanced neuroscientific techniques, it's already possible to predict which of the babies on day one of life will go on to develop symptoms of autism. The only problem is that neuroscientific method is so complicated in today's science that you cannot apply it to mass screening of thousands and thousands of newborns every day. Did you have a question back there? No? Okay, all right. But that is what the scientists are working on now, is to how to convert that complicated science into a mass screening method so that we can pick them up at birth, start treating them within the first 3 months of life, and the brain is completely rewired by 2 years of age. 30 years from now, we'll not see a single case of autism in societies where they are doing routine newborn screenings. Does that sound like crazy? That sounds like futuristic, but it is true. Now, whether we'll have that in India, I don't know. Maybe we'll have advancement of routine newborn screenings that will pick that up even in India. But basically, in societies that will be able to do routine newborn screenings, we will not have any older child or adult with autism. Period. That's it. So the American Academy of Pediatrics' present policy statement about autism is autism is fully treatable. It's fully treatable. Okay. Now, yes, go ahead.
Can training or environment reverse or rewire some of the natural responses? Say when you're sad, you cry, you're happy, you laugh, you smile. Can my training, can my environment be manipulated so much, or does it have so much of our determination that I change my responses when I'm sad, I laugh, and when I'm happy, I cry? Can such amount of training?
So, did everybody hear that great question? Let me give you a stark example. the early ancestors of humankind, and I'm very interested in human history in terms of where we came from, the very first human, Lucy, and all of that, because that leads to how we gradually acquired what we have today. So the early humans developed in Africa 2 to 3 million years ago. About 200,000 years ago is when we finally get the Homo sapiens, the modern species that we belong to. And about 80,000 years ago, our species moved out of Africa and spread to the rest of the world. We all looked the same about 80,000 years ago. And based on which part of the world we moved to, scientists have even calculated how much of sunshine leads to the darker skin and how much of lack of sunshine leads to the blonde hair, white skin in Norway. And it is simply a matter of that. Temperature and sunshine that led to why we look different. If you look at even Indian society, southern India, which is where the first migration out of Africa, they went along the coastline of the Arabian Sea and arrived in southern India. And the people who migrated north and became lighter skinned arrived from the north as Aryans. And in India has become a blend of the north and the south. Eventually, we are all mass, so to speak. Yes? That's because they were separated from the rest of the continent a long time ago. That's why. It's a very interesting discussion. Probably we should go there today.
Sorry, I'm not sure where I'm going with it. Why you talk about race, but I mean, I was getting you for the most part, but I mean, it's still that I was saying completely why we talk about race. And, the way we are talking about race is, it seems to be, I'm not a natural technical scientist, I'm a humanist by training. It seems that something that you use in social and cultural category almost is, the way we are talking about race is then it's being naturalized to some extent, which is a very dangerous and almost unethical approach to race.
That is true. So the neuroscientists that work on the ethnic differences in our cerebral faculties, raising some very inconvenient answers. And when they publish those papers, they have to be very careful that those papers don't come out and come across as racist. Because I'll give you a very non-controversial example of that. One of the sidearms of our human race, the Neanderthals. You're probably familiar with that group of people. And I actually had a very personal experience with this because for many, many years I spent working on the molecular biology of genes expressed in the brain. And then about 10 years ago, I was in our Museum of Natural History in San Francisco, and there was a whole section on Neanderthals where, based on bone impressions, that recreated the face and of the Neanderthal and how they worked. Neanderthals were very interesting animals. We're all animals. Even though we may not want to feel that way, we are all animals. We're just a little bit more rational and logical than other animals. And so they had a hard time learning from their own mistakes. How do we know that? If you look at the fossils of Neanderthals, they have injuries because they used to grapple their other animals for food, the meat specifically. And you would never think of doing this. Like fighting the bear was twice your size, but the Neanderthal would. And so there are fossils of like a skeleton of a bear and a Neanderthal with multiple fractures and of the Neanderthal skeleton. And you think, what the heck was this guy thinking? But that's how they were. In present day life, if somebody would do that, you'd call them plain stupid. Well, then if you call them that, then it becomes very inconveniently racist or otherwise. But Neanderthals made very interesting problem-solving choices. And when I looked at the, so that to me was very interesting. And then when I looked at the face of the Neanderthals at the museum, it immediately struck to me that the face of them looks like things that take care of them, which is like, this is odd. But then today with genetic techniques, we have the ability to match up the genes of one species with another species and see what is different. And I was thinking, right there in the museum, I wonder whether anybody has done exactly that. They compared the gene combination of a Neanderthal with the present day humans. And lo and behold, somebody had. Anthropologist in East Germany, the University of Leipzig. And he had done exactly that and come up with four genes that were off from Neanderthals. He was not an early childhood development specialist like I am. And he's an anthropologist. So he had no clue what these four genes do. But true to being a scientist, he started looking into what do these four genes do. And lo and behold, all those four genes are involved in autism. As I was reading his papers, I had a shiver down my spine. Oh my goodness, yes.
Sorry, if I could take a
So does that answer your question?
Partly, it's where I'm being insistent a bit. Then the next question that comes up is what are the ethical boundaries because we are dealing with living subjects, right? And there are social science disciplines where we also deal with living subjects, and there are ethical boundaries, especially guidelines that guide this kind of research. So what would be the ethical boundaries in cases as these, as you operate in? Because for us, it would be completely, I mean, we cannot even imagine a project where we can actually propose something of a comparison, genetic comparison or technical comparison of the Neanderthal fossil and the human fossil, human fossil or sapien fossil. It would be completely shot down by the ethics committee immediately.
So yes and no, depends on how creative you are in forming the question, keeping it strictly academic and not judgmental. So scientists are doing that around the world. That they're looking at the neuroscientific connections and the genetics across the world, across ethnicities and different races. But like you said, when they publish the data, they do it very carefully to keep it very factual and not judgmental, which is very different. You know, the United States has had a long history of racism, and back in about 150 years ago, there were deans of universities who would make public statements that Negroes are stupid. I mean, it's in writing. I mean, it's like, how stupid can you be? But then that's how it was. Now, you know, we're coming up with, for example, I'll give an example. You probably watched movies produced by Pixar. And Pixar, I've been there because I'm from San Francisco, right? And Pixar uses a lot of digital animators. And there's a particular ethnic group that's very good at this particular art, people from the Philippines. So an unusual high number of people in that division of Pixar are from the Philippines. They just have something up here, genetics and post-birth exposure-wise, that they develop this faculty that they're very good at.
Sumit, just to interrupt a bit, our colleagues from history, they have a faculty meeting at 5. So
what time is it?
It's 5 o'clock right now. So what we'll do is, we'll continue with this discussion, but we'll also meet up after dinner.
Absolutely.
And have a closer conversation with some of these very intricate ideas about the ethical boundaries, about various kinds of the social and the natural sciences and overlaps. So this, I think, would
be wrong if I couldn't, because you guys have been raising such exciting questions.
I just had one question, which was about intervention. So the interventions that you're talking about are all very good, all genetic. right? So
no, I'm actually talk about that. Maybe when you guys come back after dinner, and we'll talk about that.
I wanted to hear some of your stories as you were talking. You started to talk about it, and then we digressed. I wanted to hear some of your stories that you started talking about 3-year-olds and 16-year-olds, and what kind of interventions are required.
Right. We'll talk about situations. Yeah, very good question. We'll talk about it. So good luck with the meeting, and I'll catch up after the meeting.
Sorry.
We'll see you later.
Thank you.
Okay. So I'm going to summarize all of this, that we are born with a certain set of genes that affect our brain function, and then as a result of the environmental stimulation afterwards, our brain is wired in advantageous or disadvantageous ways, and then that results in us adults and our personalities or strengths or weaknesses. There are many studies. I'll just mention two that illustrates this. We are in a digital age. For those of you here who have kids or have nephews and nieces, I suggest that they do not have any access to any kind of digital media till after 3 years of age. Studies are showing that exposure to digital media, whether it is TV or tablets or mobile devices, disrupts a particular part of our brain called the attentional control center in our frontal cortex. What does the attentional control center do? It helps you pay attention to what I'm talking about. It helps me pay attention to listen to your questions and figure out who in this group is completely bored and who is very engaged. I'm paying attention to each one of you, and you're paying attention to me. When you may have far more pressing things like a paper to write, a test to take, or something, a serious illness of a family member or a parent, and in spite of many other distractions, you're paying attention and I'm paying attention right here, right here. And that part of the brain is disrupted. Like, the science is actually very scary. And the electrical circuitry of that part of the brain, the attentional control of the frontal cortex, is completely disrupted if they're consistently exposed to digital media in the first 3 years of life. What does that lead to? A very common condition called attention deficit and hyperactivity syndrome, ADHD or ADD. Okay? And then what do we do today? We treat them with medicine. How stupid is that? So let's get rid of the devices for kids under 3, and we'll reduce the risk of ADHD. Not that we'll get rid of every ADHD that is out there, but it will drastically reduce the number of ADHD. Why is ADHD rising? It's no secret. When we were kids, we used to call, I grew up in the era before television. The first time I saw television was at the age of 20. And the first time I saw a computer was at the age of 26. And we used to call the TV an idiot box. Even today, I don't spend too much time watching TV, only if I have to. And the computer, of course, I use quite a bit. That's one example of that environmental stimulation and its effect on the brain function. There is another one, if you want to do a little research, write this down, SpongeBob effect. So people have actually, I like your nod, you have heard of this, this is great. So people have actually studied, there's a show in the United States, maybe it's available in this country, called SpongeBob. It's a cartoon character, a little funky, little spongy kids, SpongeBob SquarePants. And that show, the show has something that rivets the attention of a young kid because it has what we call shock effect. Like if you ever watch a SpongeBob episode, the
what is happening in streams rapidly changing. So, then SpongeBob over there, then something is over there, and this cousin is doing something stupid over there. And before even you can think through what is going on, the screen event is rapidly changing. And just watching about a little under 10 minutes of SpongeBob every day for about 6 to 12 months reduces a child's IQ by 10 points. No kidding. So it's very easy for my kids to get off SpongeBob effect. I just simply put it like, do you guys want to be stupid or smart? And if you keep watching SpongeBob, you'll reduce your IQ by 10 points incrementally till you become mentally retarded. And the next day they were like, no, I don't want to make myself stupid. Who wants to make myself stupid? So we can do things to our minds that can make us lose mental faculties. Okay?
All right.
Yeah?
There are several music compositions, either vocal or instrumental, based on particular time, like monsoon. The monsoon and raga, or the early morning raga. We can feel the same effect while I'm hearing that music based on the monsoon season, and in that monsoon time, I can have the same effect. Is there any neural signaling pathway connection in stimulation of those stimulation induced by those sound frequencies, and the same induction can be happened at that particular monsoon time or the early morning time?
The answer is yes. I wish somebody would actually study neuroscientifically the effect of that, our rich heritage in music. How old do you think a child can kind of appreciate music? Does anybody want to venture? It's actually 4 months of fetal life. So I was just reading the study, which if you are soon to be pregnant or otherwise, or have already had a baby, you think like, who are these volunteers who volunteered for this study? But music was played with a transvaginal speaker throughout the pregnancy. And by 4 months of pregnancy, the baby's movements actually, baby's not quite doing rap dance inside the uterus, but starts to be affected by the music. 4 months of fetal life, amazing. To specifically go back to that, there is a part of our brain called the hippocampus, which sits somewhere right in the middle of it. Well, that is the brain's internal video recorder. Truth be told, we would have never, never, ever invented movies or TV if we didn't have a mental movie in our minds all the time. We've been wanting to make movies probably for centuries or even longer, like thousands of years, except we didn't have the technology till when the technology came along. Like, aha, I've had this movie in my mind all day long, and I have now have a technology to turn it into a movie with present day technology. So, if I can just pause here and ask everybody to close their eyes. Okay? Everybody close their eyes. Okay? Please close your eyes. Okay. And with your eyes closed, try to see if you have a movie in your mind of the last 5 minutes of this talk. Okay? Do you have a movie in your mind of the last 5 minutes of this talk? Yeah?
Yes.
You did? Right? That is me. Our brain is constantly recording everything that we're experiencing in the hippocampus. And some of it, we're constantly editing what we're recording and storing also. So sometimes we may have driven from Gaya to Nalanda and seen a stray dog. We know in India we see stray dogs a lot. And and we decided that, you know, yeah, I could choose to tape it and record it and save it in my hard drive, but I wouldn't believe that one. Whereas somebody, you know, I grew up in India, so when I see that, it's not a big deal. My son, who is growing up in the United States, said, we don't have stray dogs there. So he's always impressed by how many stray dogs there are here. And he's recording this and saving this in his mind in great detail. And he's going to go back and talk to his classmates about this too. Guess what? He went to India and saw so many, not just stray dogs, but calves and buffaloes and all kinds of animals on the street. Not in a necessarily in a derogatory fashion, but it's a unique experience for him. Then he's going to save that recording. The same way, if you were to travel to a different country, what is mundane for that society may not be mundane for you, and you'd find it very uniquely interesting and choose to save it in your mind. And when a director makes a movie, the director actually has the entire movie in his or her mind even before the movie is made. And then as the movie is being made, may alter it a little bit based on the progress. But the movie is already there. And then you just bring it to reality, right? Yeah, you agree? Yeah. Anybody disagree with that statement? No. So going back to your ragas and rain, we do have recordings of rain and the way we feel and the music. Sometimes, even if you think about it, and sometimes you're like, well, this is kind of strange, but say, especially the longer you live, you'll have actually more of these experiences that maybe in your younger days, in a particular fun party while it's raining outside, you guys were enjoying a certain yummy food, and then 20 years later, you are in a noisy environment where it is raining outside. That whole video recording comes back to your mouth, and you're secretly drooling. I wish I was having that samosa. Okay. So, or whatever you were having. And so, we actually associate certain things as we record events in our mind, and then as we move along, those recordings, we replay those recordings and experience them. Does that make sense? Any questions?
Sir, if a man is here who is blind from his childhood, so this happens to him also? Like the monsoon and correlation of that with music. He haven't been picturized with rain or anything, greenery, or autumn or spring, but does he picturize that by listening to that type of music?
That's why I say you guys raise such interesting questions, and this happens to me at every audience I talk with. The audience comes up with more brilliant questions than I could ever think about. So this is great. So a blind person who cannot see still has, usually, I mean, you know, it's very unusual for somebody to lose all their five senses. Well, then that's a problem. But if they're just blind, they can still hear, they can taste, they can smell, they can touch. Okay? And have you ever had close experience with a blind person yourself? No? Okay. I have. And I had at a time when I was not into this line of work at all. But as I move into this line of work, I remember the experience. And so a blind person become very hyper acute in their other senses, their hearing. It's a kind of cliche, but blind people can be very good musicians. You can probably think of one, right? And they are very good with the sense of smell, touch, feel. They are so good that they can experience their whole world. Maybe not the same way as you and I do, but to a great detail. And so now I'll give you that anecdote. An uncle of mine who was a very good musician and a music teacher, was blind since a very young age. And we were little, and he would be sitting there on his bed, and we would enter the room. Every single time, he would know who entered the room, me or any of my cousins. So one day, I asked him, how do you know? We'd even try, like, you know, we'd like tiptoe into the room, you know, me and my cousins, and he'd know right away. You know, my nickname is Raja, and he's like, and you know, if you understand Bengali, you'd know. Sikire, Raja Naki, meaning, is that Raja? And I was like, so one day I asked him, how do you know? How do you know whether it's me? And he just had a smile on his face, and he said, I can smell you. I can feel your footsteps have a very different signature pattern than your cousin. And just the way you move around the room, which I would have never thought, but we all actually move differently. And he has a very good map of me without ever knowing how I look like. And he could every single time tell who among my cousins have entered the room. Does that answer your question?
So plus there is a theory also that the bond mind people do visualize their dreams, do visualize things in their dreams. So how do these things functionalize?
So before I answer your question, the question is about dreams. I have to give you a little background on the neuroscience of dreams, which is very different than the Freudian idea of dreams, of the way Freud explained it, and later on other psychologists did. So we now actually know very well what dreams are. And if I explain to you, you'd think about all the dreams you've had, and you'd go like, yeah, that makes sense. So our hippocampus in the brain is this ginormous tape recorder, or a video recorder, that tapes everything, right? And then we consciously bring it back to our memory. If we want to think about our last birthday party we had, or our cousin's wedding, or a great time we had with our parents or friends or whatever, we can actually literally decide, let's look at that movie now, and you can go to that movie and watch it in your mind. When we fall asleep, that control of what we want to look at is lost. And all kinds of recordings start spitting out of the hippocampus in random combination. And that is basically what dream is. That's why we never remember our dream, because when we wake up, we remember the actual recording. So for example, it is not unusual for us to have a dream of, like, you know, that's why dreams are so crazy, that you're sitting in a classroom with your mom. Because maybe you're in one part of your recording, you're sitting with your mom. In another recording, you're sitting in a classroom with somebody, but when all those memories come out in a random fashion, you're sitting next to your mom, and your dream is like, oh, hi mom, what are you doing here? You know. So that's how our dreams are. And so dreams are nothing but random replays of what is already recorded in our video recorder in the hippocampus in a random fashion. Does that make sense, what I just said? Yeah? So blind people, for example, and deaf people are also similarly an interesting experience. So blind people or deaf people or anybody with a lack of one particular sense have a video recording that's missing that particular faculty. They still have dreams. So a blind person may not have a dream the way you and I would, but they still have auditory or dreams. And they would have smell dreams. So if, for example, if they, you know, I'm blind, and I'm hearing the sizzle of the paratha, and then I'm smelling the paratha, then I'm eating the paratha, it's super yummy. And in my dream, some smell or sound or taste will be recombined to be created. Does that answer your question? Yeah.
This is such an interesting topic, and it can
go hours, forever, right?
That's right.
Yes.
So I think what we should do is try and complete it in about 10 minutes more.
Yep.
And try and expose our students and others in the audience to what are the new areas, what are the possibilities for interventions that is emerging.
Let me sit through my talk, and then afterwards, if you have further questions, like I said, we can go on for days. Okay? So I'm just going to sit through. All right. So early childhood intervention, we talk about the importance of early childhood intervention is because it is hard to catch up with all the stuff that needs to be done if it starts at an older age. You know, there's less of a homework to catch up if you start at 6 months of age rather than 5 years of age or 16 years of age. And the intervention that we do alters the developmental trajectory of a preschool child. What does that mean? Meaning that the child may have been growing one way, and once you intervene, their neural circuitry in the brain changes and they become a different person, basically. And they acquire more skills and they do more interesting stuff. And if done properly, they become normal. So I'll give you an extreme example. A big group of kids I take care of are premature babies. I don't know whether within your family or personal experience you've ever had an experience of a premature baby, but in the United States, in my clinic, it's not unusual for me to come across a completely normal 2-year-old kid who was born in 24 weeks of pregnancy. 24. That is about how many months early? Right? Yeah, that baby weighed maybe about 400 grams at birth as opposed to 2.5 kilograms. And preemies are actually even more challenging because most of our brain cells are added in the third trimester. From 28 weeks of pregnancy onwards, the brain cells. So a regular child has the same number of brain cells as an adult. A preemie doesn't start its life that way. A preemie has actually, if it's born before 28 weeks, which is what we call extremely premature babies, have far less brain cells. So not only with therapy, we have to increase their number of brain cells, as well as their connectivity. And then, by 2 years of age, I mean, of course they're not normal at 6 months of age, at all, but they're bridging the gap, by 2 years of age. Isn't that amazing how we can do that? So that's why it alters the developmental trajectory of a preschool child. That's the brain. A brain is not just a, I always like the Harrison Ford movie where some Indian guy is eating a monkey brain. When I first went to the United States, there was one guy, not well informed, thought that my favorite dish is monkey brains. And I had to ask him, where did you get that crazy idea from? And he said, well, it was the Harrison Ford movie. And so we like to think of brain as a yummy piece of tissue. It is not. It's very complicated. It has, as you can see, we can go for hours and hours and hours and weeks talking about what this does, but it has different parts which do different things. And not just simple motor things of me moving the arm or smell, touch, and feel, but also higher intellectual functions. That is why the gap between brain science and psychology is gone. So all those psychotic people and all those people with weird personalities and their psychological problems, they all have to do with certain parts of the brain. Today, it is possible to treat depression with some magnetic hacks that can, by 3D way, change the functions of certain brain parts that come into play with depression and tweak it and get rid of the depression without medication. The technology is being developed for mass use even as we speak. And it is kind of weird to imagine that we all wore those hats and got into just right so we were the same amount of happy all the time. That would be kind of boring as a human race, don't you think? If we were all the same that way. So that's how complicated the brain is. And in autism and some other severe early childhood development problems, about 12 to 14 different parts of the brain will arrive before we see the symptoms. And that's why it's so much of more if we started at 5 years of age, next year possible. And the earlier you start, you can tweak all these different parts of the brain. My job is actually to deconstruct the brain function into its component parts and find out which part needs tweaking. That's basically what I simply do. The example I give to parents is, think of a car mechanic to whom you brought your car because the car is not moving. Well, the car can be not moving because it is a flat tire, a jam brake, or a broken engine, or whatnot. And it could be many different reasons why the car is not moving. But part of the job of the mechanic is to deconstruct the problem, figure out exactly what is going on, why the car is not moving, and fix that, rather than randomly have a magical cure for a non-moving car. So that way, even for autism or other, it's not a magical cure. We just have to deconstruct what brain faculties are off and address those. So we all kind of have an idea what the brain does. We don't always think about what more does the brain do. So this is no shape or form a comprehensive list of what the brain does. This is a list of what we don't always think about what the brain does. So what does our brain do? A very important one is attentional control, paying attention to what we are interested in. Do you think a newborn baby has attentional control? No, we said that in a baby's just eat, eat, move, and sleep, so they don't. But at what age does a baby develop attentional control, meaning starts to decide that this is what I'm going to pay attention to? Can anybody venture an answer? What? Three what?
3 years.
3 years? The correct answer is yes.
I was actually going to say, I mean, they're very focused on feeding.
Well, that's a more of a reflex.
It's an impulse, but it is.
Yeah, that's a reflex. Yeah, if you touch the cheek of a newborn baby, even though it's not the mother's nipple, the baby will go.
Yes.
So, but that's not attentional control. That's a reflex. Attentional control starts developing between 4 and 6 months of age. When, if you have any experience in personal lives, you watch a 4 to 6 month old baby and the other adults in the room are talking, that baby will turn to who's talking? Who's talking? What are you doing? Are you going to change my diaper or what? What's my food? And it's already doing it, okay? It's applying the attentional control of the brain. So if I don't see that in a 6 month old baby, I'm already worried. Because we learn by doing attentional control. Because if we want to learn how to write, we pay attention to somebody writing and learn that activity. And of course, then later on in life, we learn far more complicated things. Impulse control. Our body wants to naturally do all kinds of stuff. To give a stark example, 200,000 years ago, we were animals roaming in the jungles of Africa. I don't think we were toilet trained, were we? No, we were peeing and pooping everywhere. And then somehow we decided that makes our living environment stinky, and whatever it was, and then that, and other animals can smell our scent and attack us, and therefore we started to become toilet trained. Now we're very advanced toilet trained people. And we had to control that impulse of peeing and pooping anyway. Of course, sometimes we do meet people who don't always have that impulse control, but that's beside the point. Okay, all right, so we do have impulse control. We just don't do what naturally comes to our mind. Imitate. We learn by imitation. We learn everything by imitating a person who knows what he or she is doing. We pay very close attention to that. So, for example, I'll give you an example of that. Pretend this is a table, so I'm just raising it up. I was going to do it in the table, then I realized that people in the back may not be able to see. So pretend this is the surface of a table, and I decide I'm going to pretend that this is a choo-choo train, and even though it's not, and put one behind the other, and make choo-choo, choo-choo, choo-choo. What age do you think a kid will see that? Like, that's so cool, I want to do that. And watch me do that and imitate what I'm doing and start doing that himself or herself. What age? Anyone want to take a guess? 10? Yes, 1 year. And if you watch that 1-year-old learning that activity, it'll be really focused. How are you doing it? We'll be watching my hands and my eyes and learn that activity by imitating what I am doing. And then we love to clap. Don't we all love to clap? And I won't go into the details of the neuroscience of playing, but even this fun activity that playing involves brain function. And so brain function is a partial result of our genes. We talked about that, our nature. And then we expose them to all kinds of stimulation, and that's what gives us nurture. And what early childhood intervention does, it rewires the brain. And today's science, we can diagnose, like in preemies, the problems with the brain function as early as 6 months of age, and something like autism by 12 months of age. And if we do the appropriate treatment by 3 years of age, their brain has been completely rewired, it's completely functioning normally. That doesn't mean that their brain looks normal, but it has been rewired to function normally. To give it, you say a brain is an electrical organ. So for example, if that fan is not running because there is a broken circuitry of that wire, then you may not be able to fix that wire. You may add an extra wire that leads into the fan and provides electricity for that fan to run, but that fan is running dead. So it rewires the brain. Okay? So we are actually able to use neuroscientific techniques to, in real time, follow the circuitry in the brain. It actually happens very fast, but in today's digital technology, it actually happens within nanoseconds. But in digital technology, you can record that event and then play the slow motion to actually find what path that electrical impulse took within the brain for a particular function to happen. And early childhood intervention rewires the brain. And therefore, by rewiring the brain, it improves brain function and restores essential functions of the brain, making that preemie was born at 24 weeks and at 6 months quite developmentally challenged, a completely normal 2-year-old baby or toddler. Okay, what does that mean? 47 billion. In the United States, we have, on an average, spend $47 billion every year for law enforcement, jails, police officers, and the whole nine yards. $47 billion. It turns out that 15% of prison inmates in the United States have developmental issues. And because it is not so exciting to talk about this, that society, we decide to put criminals in jails rather than provide early childhood intervention to prevent them from getting into a jail to begin with, which save a major amount of money, $47 million. And it can be diagnosed as early as 6 months of age, problems of early childhood development. And untreated, it can lead to crime and unfulfilled potential of a child, meaning if the child has developmental challenges, that child could not be as functional and smart as could be. Studies are showing that you all know about Bill Gates, right? Well, there's quite a bit of speculation that people like Bill Gates and Steve Jobs have some form of autism. If they can function at a certain point, studies are now showing that people with autism, if their some of their deficits can be fixed, they can actually function far more at a higher level than us average normal people. So their unfulfilled potential is lost because these are very special people. People say Einstein probably also had some form of autism. I think that's what he did. So early childhood intervention rewires the brain, improves brain function, restores essential functions. But we talked about 47 billion, right? How much we spend in the United States for law enforcement. Hold on, sort of say, maybe I'll answer your question at the end because we have this time crunch. And studies have shown that for every dollar that we spend on early childhood intervention, which is intervention in the first 3 years of life, that's the definition of early childhood intervention, the financial return to society in terms of less prisoners and more economically productive adults is eightfold. Amazing. Instead of housing them in prisons and chronic care facilities of the mentally retarded, we can actually have functioning people that are contributing to society. That is the connection of my talk to what you guys do. I really enjoyed this. Like I pointed out earlier, this is the first time I'm talking out of my league to non-pediatricians and non-parents. And definitely the first time I'm talking in front of my own parents and my own son. So this is great.
Yeah. I think it's fascinating for us as well because here in the School of Ecology and Environment Studies, what we are trying to achieve is also the link between environment and human and how this plays out, right? And this is exactly what you are trying to sort of bring about from your own research, from your own understanding. And I think it was quite fascinating to understand and explore a certain other dimensions than what we are looking on a day-to-day basis, right? So I think we all enjoyed immensely what you did. Glad to have you with us, glad to have your parents with us, whom I know for several years now, as wonderful people who have raised a wonderful child, and as the, he's a father now, he's raising another wonderful child, two children actually. So I'm immensely happy to have all of you with us. The school is happy to have you and have this discussion. We'll have more as we go along. We'll have some more time over tea and coffee just now. And then maybe after dinner we can have a smaller group to continue this discussion a little bit more. And I would ask our Vice Chancellor Gopa to hand over a small memento. Thank you.
And,
please join us for some tea and snacks.